one of the things we want to figure out when solving a circuit is the maximum power that can be delivered to a load. Let's draw a very simple circuit with two resistors and a voltage source. Now this resistor is our load, so that just means that's the one we need to figure out the maximum power for. We will label that RL, and this resistor we will label R. The voltage we will label V, and of course there is a current flowing in the circuit. Let's start by first figuring out the power delivered to our load. We know power is equal to the current squared multiplied by the resistance. Since this is a series circuit, the current is the same for this resistor and this one. Now, how do we actually figure out what this current is? Well, we can use Ohm's law. Current is equal to the voltage divided by the resistance. So here, it's V divided by our total resistance in this circuit, which is R plus RL. Let's plug this value back into our power equation. Now the question is, what value of RL will give us the biggest power value? Well, using calculus, we can actually figure that out. All we need to do is differentiate this equation with respect to RL and then set it equal to zero. Now, without getting into the nitty-gritty details of this, what you will end up getting is that if RL is equal to R, so if the value of this resistor is the same as this resistor, then you get the maximum power transfer. To showcase this, let's plug in some numerical values. So let's go with a 5-volt source, a 6-ohm resistor, and RL, we will start off at 1 ohm. So our equation would look like this, and all we're going to do is plug in different RL values. At 1 ohm, we get 0.51 watts. Now we plug in 2, then 3, and so forth. According to what we found earlier, at 6 ohms, so when our RL is the same as R, we should get the biggest value. And at 6 ohms, we get 1.041 watts. Now if we plug in 7 ohms, notice how it's going back down. We will stop at 10 ohms, but we can see that once we go past 6 ohms, the power decreases again. So the takeaway from this is that when RL has the same value as R, that is the maximum power transfer possible. So you might be thinking, well, this is a very simple circuit, but what happens when we get really big, complicated circuits? Now let me ask you a question. Doesn't this circuit look really familiar? That's right. It's just a Thevenin's equivalent circuit, and we know we can represent any circuit we want as a Thevenin's equivalent circuit that looks just like this one. So when we need to figure out maximum power transfer, all we need to do is use Thevenin's theorem to create a simple circuit, and then we can figure out the values we want. Now let's go through a few examples to understand how to find the maximum power transfer. It should be noted here that you must know how to use Thevenin's theorem, so if you need a refresh, please watch that video first. Let's start with a nice simple example, where we need to figure out the RL in order to get the maximum power transfer and what that maximum power is. So really, what we need to do is convert this circuit into a Thevenin's equivalent circuit. Let's go through the motions of doing that. The first step is to remove our load and figure out the open circuit voltage. If we write a KVL for this loop, we can get the VOC, but to do that, we need the voltage in this resistor and this one. We can easily figure those out by writing two mesh equations, and we can pick both mesh currents to be clockwise. Since this is an open circuit here, there is no flow of current in this section of the circuit. Let's write an equation for the left mesh. So we enter the negative terminal of our voltage source, then we have 2k ohms times I1, and then 6k ohms times I1 minus I2. Since we are writing our mesh equation for I1, and I2 is opposing the flow of current through the 6k ohm resistor, it'll be I1 minus I2. If this is unfamiliar to you, I have a whole video on mesh analysis, so please watch that first. It should be noted that whenever I write K, it represents 1000, and M represents 10 to the negative 3. This makes it easier to write down values rather than writing 8000 ohms or 0.002 amps. Let's simplify this equation. Next, we can write an equation for the second mesh. This time, we're writing the mesh equation for I2, and I1 is opposing the flow of I2 through the 6k ohm resistor. So we get I2 minus I1. Let's simplify this equation, and then we can use substitution to solve them. So let's isolate for I1 in the first equation. Let's plug this value into our second equation. Now we can solve for I2. Using the I2 value we found, we can figure out I1. Now we can use Ohm's law to figure out the voltage in each of these resistors. So this one is just 2k ohms multiplied by I1, and we get 4 volts, and this one is 4k ohms multiplied by I2. Next, we can write a KVL for this loop going clockwise. Let's solve for VOC, and we get 16 over 3 volts. Now that we have the VOC, let's figure out the equivalent resistance. So remember, voltage sources turn into short circuits. Then we look into the circuit to figure out the total resistance. These two resistors are parallel to each other, so we can combine them. Let's draw another circuit to see this better. Now we see that these two resistors are in series, and the combination of that is parallel to this resistor. We get a total equivalent resistance of 3.26 kiloohms. Now we can draw our Thevenin equivalent circuit. From the RTH, we instantly know that RL should also be 3.26 kiloohms, since for maximum power transfer, they need to have the same values. To calculate the maximum power transfer, let's use our equation. Plugging in our values and solving gives us 2.18 milliwatts, which is the maximum power transfer. Let's take a look at this problem, where we need to figure out the maximum power that can be transferred to the load resistor. So we need to convert this circuit into a Thevenin equivalent circuit. Let's start by removing the load and labeling our VOC. To figure out our open circuit voltage, we can write a KVL for this loop, but to do so, we need the voltage in this resistor and this one. Notice that since this is an open circuit here, the current from this source has to go this way. It can't go this way. The current in this branch is constrained by the current source, so that means the voltage of this resistor is simply 6k ohms multiplied by 3 milliamps. We get 18 volts. Also, since the current has to travel this way, the positive side of our resistor will be here, since current always enters the positive side using passive convention. Now what about this side? We can figure out the current in this loop using Ohm's law. So current is voltage divided by the resistance, so here that's 9 volts divided by 10k ohms plus 10k ohms. We get 0.45 milliamps, so the voltage in this resistor is then 10k ohms multiplied by the current we just found, giving us 4.5 volts. Here, since the positive side of the voltage source is on top, the current flow will be like this. So the positives for this resistor would be on this side. The only reason we need to keep track of this is for when we write our KVL, and that's what we're going to do right now. Since we know the positive and negative sides, you can write your KVL clockwise or counterclockwise. Let's go counterclockwise. We get 19.5 volts as our VOC. Next, we need to figure out the equivalent resistance. So voltage sources turn into short circuits and current sources turn into open circuits. Since this branch is no longer connected on both sides, it has no effect on the circuit, so we can remove it. Now looking at the circuit, we see that these two resistors are parallel to each other, and the combination of that is in series with this resistor. We get 11k ohms. Now we can draw our Thevenin equivalent circuit. Keep in mind that our RL is the exact same as our RTH. So now we can use our equation to get the maximum power transfer. We get 8.64 milliwatts, and that's our answer. Let's take a look at this problem where we need to figure out the value of RL for maximum power transfer and what that maximum power is. In this circuit, we have dependent and independent sources. So that means we need to get two values, the open circuit voltage and the short circuit current, to draw the Thevenin equivalent circuit. Let's start with VOC by first removing our RL and labeling VOC. When we do that, our circuit changed, so let's relabel our dependent current sources as IX1. Looking at our circuit, how can we figure out VOC? One way is to write a KVL for this loop, but to do that, we need the voltages of this resistor and this one. So let's go and figure those out. Since it's an open circuit here, we can get rid of these straggly pieces of wires to make it easier for us to see. Now we can use mesh analysis. Let's pick both mesh currents to be counterclockwise. Straight away, we know I2 is equal to 2 milliamps, since it's being constrained by the 2 milliampere current source. Now there's something else interesting happening. We can see that I1 is also constrained by a current source, a dependent current source. So that means I1 is equal to 2IX1. Now the question is, what is IX1? IX1 is the current flowing through this 6K ohm resistor, which is just 2 milliamps, since that's the branch current. So then I1 is equal to 4 milliamps. Now we can figure out the voltages in the resistors using Ohm's law. For the 6K ohm resistor, it's 2 milliamps multiplied by 6K ohms, and for the top one, it's 4 milliamps multiplied by 4K ohms. Let's also write down the positives and negatives for our resistors. So for the 6K ohm resistor, we have the current entering the top, so that's the positive side, and for the 4K ohm resistor, the current enters the right side, so that's the positive side. Let's get rid of the mesh currents and put the open circuit wires back. Now we can write a KVL and we will go clockwise. We get 16 volts. Now we need to figure out the short circuit current. So we will draw a short circuit where our load used to be and label our ISC. When we do this, our circuit has changed, so once again, we need to relabel our dependent sources. Let's label them IX2. Let's use nodal analysis to solve this circuit. This circuit has four nodes, and the bottom one we will make ground. Let's assume our current directions. Because of the voltage source here, we can assume that current will flow this way, so it'll come towards node 2. On this side, we have a dependent current source, but whatever current it produces must be the same exact current that goes through this 4K ohm resistor, since there are no other branching paths. So that current will also come towards node 2. Now there's also something else to keep in mind. The voltage of node 1 is 12 volts, since the voltage source is constraining it. Next, let's focus back at the dependent current source. Again, whatever current comes from that source must go through the 4K ohm resistor, so we don't need to focus on node 3, because the same current that enters node 3 is going to be the same for node 2. That means we can write a single equation for node 2 and solve this circuit. Since we assume the current to flow into node 2, that means the 12-volt side is at a higher potential than node 2. Why? Because current always flows from the higher potential side to the lower potential side. So we have 12 minus V2 over the 4K ohm resistor, and then on the other side, we have the dependent current coming into the node. Then we have this 2 milliamps coming into the node, and lastly, we have this current leaving the node. Again, remember that all of this is a single node, so all of the currents we mentioned are flowing into or out of a singular node. Now we need to figure out what IX2 is. That's simply the node voltage 2 divided by the 6K ohm resistor, and that will give us the current. Let's plug that value back into our equation. Now we can multiply everything by 12K. Let's simplify, and we see that node 2 is equal to 60 volts. Next, we can write a KCL for this point to figure out the ISC. Any current coming in will be positive, and any current leaving will be negative. So we have ISC coming in, 2 milliamps coming in, and IX2 leaving. We already know IX2 is equal to node 2 over 6K, and node 2 is 60 volts. Let's solve, and we get 8 milliamps. Now that we have both VOC and ISC, we can figure out RTH. We get 2 kilo ohms. Let's finally draw our Thevenin equivalent circuit. We have our 16 volt source, and our RTH was 2K ohms. That means our load is also 2K ohms. Let's use our power equation to figure out the power. We get 32 milliwatts, and that's our answer. That should cover the types of problems you will face when it comes to maximum power transfer. Thanks for watching, and best of luck with your studies.